sort of, not really forgotten, but it wasn't as prominent as it was earlier. The Green family, who owned Hobby Lobby retail chain, who donated Campus North to us several years ago, made a movie, a Hollywood movie, to tell the story. The movie was End of the Spear. And how many of you have seen that? Most of you. It's an excellent film, and it sort of brought the story back for a whole new generation of Christians to learn about and to be inspired by. Steve Saint remained in Ecuador, where he eventually lived in a close community with the Indians. Later, Saint attended Wheaton College, and afterward launched several successful businesses before returning to the Amazon in 1995. He now spends about a third of his time in the jungle every year. He established iTech, a nonprofit organization that assists the indigenous church in South America by equipping them with practical skills. He also has been a missionary in West Africa, Central America, South America. Saint's best-selling memoirs are also entitled End of the Spear. That's the where the name of the film came from. But the wife of one of the missionaries who was killed spoke here about 3 years ago, Elizabeth Elliott, and her health is not such that she can do that any longer. But we're honored to have Steve Saint here today. But before he speaks, Johnny has a trailer for the movie, just to sort of, if you haven't seen it, give you a taste of what his family has endured. And we're honored to have you here today, Steve.
Mistakes that I'm hoping that you'll correct. God had other other plans for the Waldani, it seems. My aunt, from the time she was a young girl, a teenager, about 16, said that God gave her a vision that one day, if she would be faithful to Him, He would allow her to take His word, not as her work, but as her reward for having been faithful in other times during her life, that He would allow her to take His word to a people who had never heard. When she was on her way down to Peru to do a missionary stint down there, she stopped by to visit my mom and Dad took her flying out in the jungles, but there was one part of the jungles that he wouldn't fly over, and Aunt Rachel said, "Kelly, why won't you fly over this one part of jungles?" And so my dad told her about this extremely violent group of people that lived in that territory. He said, "Sis, if we had an accident or if we had to make a forced landing there, these people would surely kill us. They killed everybody coming into their territory." My aunt told me later that she knew from that minute on, she knew that that was the people that God had promised that she could take His word to. And she was so sure of it that my dad, feeling God's call for he and his friends to take the gospel to the Waldani, he wouldn't tell my aunt that God had called them to do it. Now, if you stop the story right there, it would seem like somebody isn't hearing God. But God writes fantastic stories. And as it turns out, I'm sure that God's plan was that He would use those five seeds that He planted out there in the Amazon jungle. And I can tell you that that was a devastating happening for me, because everything in my little boy world revolved around my dad when I was just a little boy. When my mom took me into her room and told me that my dad was never coming home to live with us again, I thought that life was over. But that was only the first chapter. In the next chapter, my Aunt Rachel did go in to live with these people, and they didn't kill her. And then just a short while later, my aunt talked to my mom in one of those times of temporary insanity to let me go live with her with these people. Now, people ask me, "Weren't you afraid to go in and live with them? These people who had killed your dad just a few years before?" But look at it from my standpoint. My dad knew that there was a chance that he would be killed, he and his friends, and yet they were willing to go and give their lives, if it was necessary, to take the gospel to these people that were in the path of the oil companies moving in and were in danger of being wiped out. And then, every night we would get together, my mom would pray for these people that had killed my dad. Never did I ever sense any resentment on the part of my mother. And then my aunt couldn't wait to go in and try to live with them herself, and I expected that she would be killed too. So by the time it was my turn to go, I knew that these had to be the most special people in the whole world. I couldn't wait to meet them. I had a little surprise that when I got there, they didn't rush to me. Apparently when I got out with clothes on, they couldn't tell what I was. I was almost as tall as some of the adults, but I didn't have any obvious anatomy to show them which gender I was. So finally they took an old grandmother and sent her over to check me out. She came over and patted me down pretty good. Finally she couldn't figure out if you watched the movie, this is really true. Finally she pulled my pants out, looked down inside, and then everybody laughed. And that was really intimidating. And then they accepted me, and one of the men in the tribe, a warrior there, took me into his home and adopted me and treated me like one of his own sons. I didn't know at that point that he was one of the men that had killed my dad and Roger, Pete, and Jim. In fact, I didn't find out until just a few years ago that he was, I'm quite sure, the warrior who finally drove a spear through my dad's head and slashed his face with a machete to kill him.